here, it was in 1630s time, it took us about 5 days to get here from just from Worcester, it seemed like the rain. I'm glad you all came out for the program in face of the changing weather. I'm going to have to move really fast to meet this 8 o'clock timeline. I want to let you know that in getting prepared for this program, I've been working on this project for about 5 years now. And it's finally gotten to the point I've had enough people stop and ask me, when is the book coming out, or can you tell us what book we can read and to do exploring, that it's time for the book. And you're actually going to be helping me write the book by letting me do my presentation, because it does form the outline, I think, pretty close, of the book that I'd like to do over the course of the next year. There are a couple of things, again, as Christine brought up with the walks. I have been posting on Facebook on the Old Connecticut Path, so if you do want to know what's coming up, that's the best place to get information. In addition to the walk-in program in Vernon, we will be doing a walk on a beautiful section of the path you'll see a little later in the program up in Eastford. It's really a delight. It's only a short walk in for it. So some of my goals in sharing this story with you, this has been a journey for me, and I came up with the fact that I've been like a pilgrim on a journey. And putting together some of the stories and the places and the people that tie this all together in a way that makes more sense to me, and I hope it gives you a story that you can share also. So tonight I want to share with you my journey, a little bit of the story of the path, how it, I think it contributed to the people who came down and their accomplishments here in Connecticut, helped shape the American story, and how we can connect this with our heritage today. Pretty ambitious. The book will take a long while for you to work through. When I started this project, I felt I was pretty much out in the woods by myself. There wasn't much out there on information. You go on the internet thinking you'll find everything. There was next to nothing. I'm happy to report, if you go on the internet now, it's all about me. But I have found that I'm not alone in it. We've been doing programs and walks, and people are coming to experience this piece of our history ourselves. My part started, you know, as I started getting into this, it really started many years ago when my father was driving me to college, and we drove by this sign. He said, "Oh yes, Thomas Hooker went by here." And being young and thinking I knew it all, I didn't bother to ask him to tell me more about it. But it's actually Thomas Hooker is one of my ancestors, as you'll see. And if I'd asked my father, I would have saved myself a whole lot. There's a lesson there for the next generation. And I found out I didn't grow up in Connecticut, so I had to find these things out fresh for myself, that he was a major influence in Connecticut and in the early formations of Hartford, the New England Confederation. Some would say he was even the father of democracy. That's stretching a little bit, but he had a big hand in the process. I didn't know all this, and going back and doing the lifting, heavy lifting on my family's history, my uncle took it on, and so I didn't have to do all the genealogical stuff. So I was left to figure out where the trail was that they were following. And so I had to figure out, well, among all these people, how did I connect with Hooker? And through his daughter, Mary. Mary Hooker married Reverend Roger Newton. Roger Newton came over in 1638. He was among the first to go to Harvard. In 1640, he ran off to Connecticut and married a hooker. This is the family story. But I did figure out that one of the things that I did figure out, the ministry was a family business. As you look, that they either became ministers or they married ministers. And Susanna and Thomas Hooker had major influence and carried beyond their life. Now, I did find that, you know, yes, I have a bunch of people with Thomas Hooker and a couple of others down in Hartford, in the founders, a couple of founders over in Wethersfield. And I found that Wethersfield people came and they moved on. But I was very much surprised when I started digging into my ancestors that were connected here to Windsor. That I got all these people and they keep coming up. I have found in the last month, I think I found two more. And just keep adding to the list that all these folks have a connection to me today in this story, along with hundreds, thousands of others. So when I set out to do this, before I knew what I was really undertaking, I thought, you know, gee, can a route be found? After 375 years, now 380 years, are there places that you can go that really give you that feeling that you're on the path? And are there some artifacts that you find from those who came and those who settled along the path in later times? The answer that I have for you, and you can go home now if you want, I can say, yes, I found all that stuff. One of the things that helped is that today we don't realize, I don't believe that 100 years or more ago, this actually was a topic of great interest in there. A whole range of signs that help you figure out where you're going, that are markers, memorials to Thomas Hooker, to the travelers to Connecticut. And if you follow the signs, you can begin to get a sense of where the traditions are of the path. I had some help too with some real old maps and local histories. One that I found was down at the Mass Archives was the notorious survey map of Nathaniel Woodward and Solomon Saffrey. And it turns out that among my ancestors is Nathaniel Woodward. He's another one of my direct ancestors. And I looked at the map, and despite the notoriety in Connecticut, their survey of the distances and places between Providence and Hartford, or Providence and Windsor, was really quite accurate. Within a mile. So that they really did come. The notoriety was of where the boundary is with Connecticut, but that's another issue.
Is it Providence, Rhode Island?
Providence, Rhode Island. They came across 1642.
It's not west of Windsor, it's east.
It's upside down.
The map was upside down. That's how they drew it. Now, another who came through Windsor and helped in figuring out the route of the path was John Winthrop Jr., who set out in 1645. He said, I'm going to take a walk to New London. And 28 days later and 290 miles, he'd gone all the way across Massachusetts to Springfield, down to Windsor, and back around the coast and back up in November. So they made him hardier then. A real gem is the map of ancient Windham County. Ellen Larned, first member inducted in the Connecticut Historical Society, first woman, in her book of history of Windham County, tucked away this map that showed the route. And much of it is actually panned out to be close to or on track for the route, based on traditions and other studies. Picked up from the Bay Path from Levi Badger Chase, a route going on over to Springfield. And there was some thought and belief at one point in time that everybody went that way and then they just came down the valley. That doesn't seem to be what's held up over time, but that was one view. And then Connecticut has had great arguments about this. There was a map by Matthias Spies, and he said, you know, it went one way, and it could have gone another way, but it really was one way. I use that as one of the ways to help me figure out great debates, and we'll get a bit more of that. And then Harold Ayers in 1940 looked at it using largely Ellen Larned's map and other data, other information to track a route. So using that in local histories, the genealogies, the stories of the communities along the way, I think I've been able to figure out a route that's comprehensive and makes sense and connects the paths. And I had to accommodate the pioneer trails because there were several groups that came down to the Connecticut Valley that did follow different trails, different routes, and they wound up meeting. And they were also, thanks to my ancestor Nathaniel Woodward and Solomon Safri, we have a pretty good idea of an overland route from Plymouth here to Windsor. So take this along. I use the basis of 10 miles a day because we know they were driving cattle and you can only go so fast with cows because they like to stop and look around. Maybe we could learn something from them today. So that the first day out from Cambridge, you go day one to Weston, just beyond 128, day two down to Framingham. The groups that came from Dorchester, you'll hear more about. First day was just beyond Charles River out of Needham, and 10 miles beyond, you could join the trails out around Framingham. Day three, down around Hopkinton at Whitehall Pond. Four around Sutton, five down to Webster, Woodstock, Pine Hill, which I'll show you in a few moments, down to the Willimantic, and down to the Willimantic, and around the ninth day they would be up right around in the area of Vernon coming down the valley. And then the last day you see the branching that we might lead off to Windsor and Hartford and Wethersfield. So we have this group that we now have a sense of, you know, maybe how they did it, at least close to. We can't say I stepped on exactly each rock that they touched along the way, but some places I'd say are fairly close to right about where they were. Arriving in the Connecticut Valley, this began the westward migration of Americans. It didn't stop. So it left me with the task of, now that I've got an idea of where it might have gone, well, what was the real story behind this? And that was the bigger challenge to get into as a psychologist, getting into what would they think is doing this? And that's taken me on a whole different dimension in this journey. And one of the things that we all have, and I'm going to do this as a test, we've all been out of school a while, so we'll do this test here and see how many of you were in the same class that I was in. When it comes to colonial history, here's what I knew. And everybody stepped right off the boat onto Plymouth Rock. And since then, we've all celebrated this in school multiple times with the turkeys and the hats. And the next thing we know about history jumps down to Lexington and Concord. Now, how many of you were in that same class as I was in? It seems to be a problem with how we're teaching history that there are places that we have these black holes that we just don't know anything about. And I had to learn a lot. So one of the things that drove me as I'm doing this is we don't have the fireplace over here is that much of the traditions and the stories of families that came down got handed down by oral tradition, by the fire. And then in the 1800s, we had this burst of people writing down what they heard from their grandparents and that was handed down. And today, we don't really have a way of gathering around the fire to say, gee, what were some of the stories that they told? What made them do the things that they did? So I had to jump and figure out what was going on at this time that caused these people to uproot from England and come on over to America and then go through these great profound changes in their lifetime. And going back to England, we owe a debt to King James of England for the King James Bible and the translation of the Bible into English that made it accessible. So that was his positive contribution. One of the problems that he created was that he also wrote a little volume on the divine right of kings. And he was pretty reasonable about it as we got into this, but his son Charles took him quite literally about the divine right of kings and the king's overall authority and freedom from any judgment by any other subordinates. His dad, James, gave Charles a booklet with advice on being the king. The first thing was, don't trust Parliament, which he followed very scrupulously. He suspended Parliament for like 11 years and ruled absolutely. The other was, suppress those who dissent in religion from the Anglican Church or this Church of England. That left the Catholics, Charles was married to a Catholic, so they didn't get suppressed. And the other group was the Puritans, and they very much did. And the chief in doing this was Archbishop William Laud, who was the king's advisor, and scrupulously set about establishing a list of all ministers and identifying who was Puritan with P on the list, and then set about silencing them. Today, if you want to silence dissent and discussion, we've seen they shut down the internet. In those times, if you really wanted to silence any dissent, you shut down the ministers. And William Laud set about doing this in some rather direct and profound ways that had an impact on this migration. There's an example to what happened to one of the ministers, Alexander Layton, a minister, a Puritan minister, arrested without charges, thrown in jail without a trial, put in irons in a cell, uncovered for 15 weeks in the cold weather, tied to stake and to beaten, and then branded. And he survived. I think that's the most remarkable thing. He actually survived and was released, which is another story. Another of my ancestors, John Lothrop, was arrested on heresy along with his entire congregation. They were thrown in Newgate Prison. He served 2 years, 10 months. And during that period of time, his wife died while they were imprisoned. The only way he could get out of the country, get out of jail, was if he agreed to leave the country. So they took this suppression fairly seriously. And into this we have Thomas Hooker. And Hooker had risen to a level where he was a lecturer at Chelmsford, which is a city right outside of London, and was attracting a growing audience. And when you look at this, it's sort of like the New York Times, the book reviews, or you know, when you buy a book and you look and say, what are people saying about this book? Well, here's what people, his contemporaries, were saying, that he had no superior in thought. And Samuel Collins here went on extensively about his learning and his knowledge that none could compare to him. And he was gaining greater followers than all before him. So having tremendous influence on the populace. And during that time, Thomas and his wife Susanna and their family lived outside of at Little Bado at the Cruz farm, which is still there. And his assistant was John Elliott, which we'll hear about further, that lived with the family. But the remarkable thing there, ministers from all over Essex, around the countryside, came to meet with Thomas Hooker and discussing great issues of the day and religious belief. And again, we have Samuel Collins saying, well, everybody's coming, and they can't get enough of it. You know, what he's saying, they were outspreading. But what he was really writing was a letter to Archbishop Laud saying, basically, he must be silenced. He's getting too powerful with the populace and the ministers. Thing that, you know, when we talk about the strength of the ministry, 47 ministers from Essex signed this petition to Bishop Laud, challenging the charges that Hooker was non-conforming, that he was an honest and honorable person and minister. So they stood up to the person, to Laud, who was suppressing the ministers. And enter the story of another of Connecticut's founders, of Samuel Stone. Hooker was driven into hiding by secret police that Laud summoned in it. Rather, it was like the Gestapo. The spies that were there, they had the secret police, and they came to Samuel Stone's door, and he stood there with Thomas Hooker in the back of the house and told the police, "I saw him on the other side of town, go on over there, maybe you'll catch him." That's how serious it was at that time, so you could see what was happening to the ministers. And Hooker did have to go into exile in Holland for 3 years. And then in 1633, he was able to leave England on the Griffin with his family. Before he did, though, he gave his final sermon on leaving the country that there would be a war. And he was talking in biblical terms. But there actually was, and here's my black hole again, there was a war. And it was the English Civil War. It was a religious, economic, political base. There was great conflict and loss of life. And among the loss of life that we say shapes America's future, William Laud was beheaded, and King Charles was beheaded. So we had the king and his minister overthrown. Think about that with the Puritans coming over as an example in their life of what could happen. And this period was the period of our great migration that came from England. Where did all these people came from? The Puritans were coming out of England in which, as you can see by the way they treated the ministers and the congregations, it was dangerous to openly profess your beliefs. And there was a great migration, and a large group, over 20,000, came to New England in a short period of time. One of the bigger groups was organized around the Massachusetts Bay Company with John Winthrop as the leader. And most of the folks from the Massachusetts Bay Company, and most of those who came, actually were coming from the eastern part of England. And that was a hotbed of Puritanism. And they came in 11 ships in the Winthrop fleet, and it was about 1,200 people who came in 1630. But there was another group that was down in southwestern England, and was the started as the Dorchester Company with Reverend John White as the organizer. They formed a congregation with people who were ready and willing from this part of the country here from Devon and the surrounding counties to relocate to America. So they formed the congregation in England. They assigned the ministers, John Wareham and John Maverick, both of whom have been silenced. And the company leaders were Roger Ludlow and Edward Ross, who we'll hear more about. And they came on Mary and John leaving on March 20th and wound up at Nantasket on May 30th. So they actually were on the first ship to arrive at the Great Migration. And it works out, by the time everyone got settled, it was about a month ahead of the other group. Now the Mary and John, if you go out here on the green, it is up there on the Founders Monument. There are no copies of the plans or pictures from that period, but we have a pretty good idea how it would look. And if you really wanted to see it for real, wind down to Plymouth and take a walk on the Mayflower too. And you get a sense of what their accommodations were like on the ships on the crossings for 70 days on the Mary and John. Now this group wound up being dropped off at Nantasket, which is Nantasket Beach. The ship captain, Captain Squibb, didn't have a guide or a pilot to take him into Boston Harbor. The rocks and reefs were unknown. So the safest way was to just drop everybody off on Nantasket Beach and say, okay, figure out how to get across and have a nice life. And as Roger Clapp, who was on the Mary and John, wrote, he said, they left us in a forlorn wilderness destitute of any habitation or other comforts. And if you go out to Nantasket during the off season, If you went the last few weeks, they'd probably be shocked at the amount of flesh that they would see. But in the off-season, you get a real sense of the destitute it is and how forlorn the wilderness can be. And if you go to the upper end of Nantasket and Hall, we're going to take a look. This is the view of Boston Harbor that they might have experienced without buildings. And as you look across, this is a huge area that they were really set alone in 1630, the end of their journey on May 30th. And where they wanted to be was a substantial distance away. They were planning to be up in Watertown, which is out on the other side of Boston. And so they had to set out from the tip of Nantasket across the bay 7 miles in small boats to get to Mattapan, which they renamed Dorchester. If they went overland, it would be over 20 miles, with several rather deep rivers to get across, tidal rivers. Now, to give you some idea going across here is, this is the expanse of the bay, and they were going, let's see if I get the pointer right. I don't think I got it. They were going to Dorchester, and where the arrow is, there's a little white dot. If your vision is really good, you can see it. Just watch for the dot, because we're going to take a look as we go across the bay. The Mary and John had probably one or two long boats that they used to make this journey across the bay. And if you imagine the number of trips that it would take to move 140 people and their possessions and their animals and all sorts of other supplies. Here we are looking at it from the water level. And we're headed towards Mattapan. See if you can see the dot. Can you see the dot now? And go right through there. From 7 miles away, that's a wet speck. If you go down Route 93, the Southeast Expressway, and you're stuck in traffic, and you get to the big gas tank there, you're right where they came in. Okay? So, in the area of the Kennedy Library at UMass, and in the distance there, you can see the Great Blue Hill. So they used the Great Blue Hill as a guide point to make the journey in. And if you go there today, you can see their neighbors have really taken off into some high-rise neighborhood. But you can go right down to the beach where they are likely to come in. And the folks over at Dorchester takes their history seriously, too, and did reenactment of the landing from the Mary and John. So it brought you into where they arrived. And I'm going to take you on a quick tour because I'm supposed to be a guide on this pilgrimage. And there'll be a couple of places we'll show you along the way that if you go out, you can visit for yourselves. And the first is Rock Hill. Now remember, we said we all had a good laugh with Plymouth Rock. The Mayflower, we have Plymouth Rock. Mary and John, we have Rock Hill, which stood right above the landing place. And in that neighborhood, there is a marker commemorating the arrival. And it now is still preserved as a city park. Beautiful. And I had some real reservations going there because, you know, if you're going into the big city, you're going to have a problem. It's still a wonderful neighborhood. And it was a great neighborhood where Roger Ludlow, Edward Rassiter, Henry, they'll come back here. Anyway, they all set up their homes there, if we take a walk up the hill, we can still walk up the hill, as they might have done, to about the area where they set a fort. And from the top, we can look back across the bay where they had to grow to get from Nantasket. Another place to stop is Edward Everett Square, which is a historical area. If you get there and when the lights are all changing, you could pack your lunch and have your lunch before you get through the intersection. But in the park is the James Blake House, which is Boston's oldest house, 1661. And going down the street, just a short distance, we get to the site of the first meeting house in Dorchester. And one of the things that was in the park there that is similar to a story that's connected with their first arrival. And when we were hungry, fish was good help unto me, from Roger Clapp's autobiography. That the folks who came under Mary and John had a very hard first year. They arrived in an area that had little timber for shelter, to build shelters. They had little supplies, and the first year, the winter came early. And being out on the bay in the winter with limited shelter, most were in tents or root shelters, and they were reduced to looking for shells, shellfish, berries, anything they could find to eat. And a ship did not arrive until the beginning of February to help resupply the people who came. And so that was a hard year for those who came with Mary and John and all those others who came in the winter flu. If you continue on our little tour around Dorchester Bay, you can actually go there and walk about 3 miles along a continuous greenway along the bay. If you go down there on January 1st, you see the polar bears running into the East Street from the East Street Beach. And as we ascend Dorchester Neck, as they called it, it's called Dorchester Heights. It's now part of the National Park for the Revolutionary War, where Henry Knox established, set up the battery that helped to drive the British from Boston. And you can see Boston now just beyond all the houses that have been built up. But the view that they might have been more concerned about when they were first settlers, they used this as a meadow for grazing. And if you look to the west, out there in the hills, is the western frontier at that time, out around Newton Highlands. We'll go visit there along the way. Third place in town, or this place in town that I wanted to bring you to, is really a place that has some connection. You may find folks who have family who arrived here, who parts of their family remained in Dorchester, and they're in one of Boston's oldest cemeteries at Upheath Corner. And it's likely the spot where the congregation would have gotten together to head west on the common, and head west out along Dudley Street. We'll take a look in just a few moments at how they might have done this, but in kind of figuring out this story, there are several different ways it's been told. And one was, Thomas Hooker, he took a compass in his hand, and everybody just kind of wandered. And it's by the act of God, they wound up at the Connecticut River, and they all bowed down and gave thanks. Another is this more romantic view that it was sort of like a walk in the park, and they had picnics, catered lunches. There was a great deal more thought that went into this process, and I had to find these things out. Connecticut sachem, Wagenicut, gotta get that right, came up from Hartford, or the area of Hartford, in 1631, and he met with John Winthrop, and he said, come on down. I think the natives of Connecticut are probably saying, what was he thinking? Inviting these people down. He was actually looking to have the English come down as part of mutual defense. They didn't come down, John Winthrop didn't send anyone down, but John Oldham did come down in 1633, and he came back and he said, go on down. He came from Watertown, and word of what's down here spread, and others came down. In 1635, folks in Dorchester and Cambridge finally got permission to leave and come to Connecticut. So in September, which was a tough time for them to decide to do this, they set some small groups down to check out here to Windsor and to Hartford. And they had a really hard time because they came in September and winter comes awfully quick. And that first year was very difficult, and hard time, and some just packed up and went back. But the larger groups did finally get organized to come. It seemed like 1636, we had groups from Dorchester, Watertown, Cambridge, and who am I leaving out here? Roxbury, heading on down to Connecticut. So we had a number of groups going down, and the group from Dorchester and Mary and John, we know they head out somewhere around April 16th, so they got a good early start. And their next stop would be Roxbury. And if you go to Roxbury, it's now part of the National Heritage Park. And John Elliott Square is there. And John Elliott, aside from being the assistant with Thomas Hooker over in England, came to America as part of the migration and was minister at Roxbury and continued in his ministry till 1690 and was the apostle to the Indians and went along the path and formed Christian congregations in praying Indian towns along the way. And from this, we get some sense of the line of travel that he followed in going out to and coming back from the praying Indian towns. Now along the way, as we went west from Roxbury, there is a parting stone where the trails diverged, and the one went west. And our next stop is if you go out to Jamaica Pond and the Emerald Necklace. We cross over there on the Bay Path. And I bring to your attention Frederick Law Olmsted. He's one of Connecticut's own. He was involved in landscape park design, development in over 500 projects across the country. The Emerald Necklace in Boston was one of them. Central Park is another. And the parklands around the state capitol in Hartford is another. Another connection, though, is he was born down here in Connecticut, in Hartford. His ancestor, James Olmsted, was one of the founders of adventurers who came to Hartford. And James's son, Nicholas, married Sarah Loomis from over here in Windsor. So we have a Windsor-Hartford connection with Frederick Law Olmsted. And heading west to that gateway on the western frontier, you can go there today, to the area that they were likely crossing the Charles at the Hemlock Gorge Reserve. And the story is that at that time, there were stones that the natives placed there that helped them to walk across the river. And it also was a gathering place because of the falls. It was a gathering place of the natives when the fish runs were happening in the spring. So if you go there today, the field next to the sign is likely where the Indians brought the fish up to dry. And you can see the dam that stands there is right at the side of the falls. And it's a beautiful parkland to walk along, and it was the western frontier. Beyond there at that time, you didn't go to live, you went for the day, and you came back home. So we'll leave the folks from Dorchester for a moment to pick up with Thomas Hooker, and we have a record of him leaving from Boston, from Cambridge in 1636. Thomas Hooker left for Newtown, driving 160 cattle with his wife on a litter, and they drank milk all the way. It was a nice story. I think Susanna Hooker had other things. She wasn't an invalid necessarily, unless you consider having three children under the age of 5 years being an invalid. I think that there was an accommodation. Traveling west along the what's now later became the Post Road, you get up to Wayland, and there's this sign, it talks about hard to find. It says Old Connecticut Path and a monument, and you drive through some really truly beautiful country still between Wayland and Framingham. And in Framingham, we have the monument to the natives who brought corn to Boston in 1630 when the English settlers of the Great Migration in Dorchester were starving. They would not have survived without the support and help of the natives. So you get the picture that you have the two groups coming together down around Framingham. It's likely there's an area, there are several ponds in Framingham Center, but there's likely to be in the area of Washakum Pond. And in doing this project, you don't realize how many of the names in our places are really Indian names. They're names that come from the natives. And Washakum is still there. Connecticut is actually a native name. And just a short distance, within 2 miles, you cross over a hill and down through the Wildwood Cemetery in Ashland. And you can see the Wagunko Hill and where the Indian Prairie and Village was down below there. And in Ashland, there is the Powell Rock, which marks the crossing place of the party that went to Connecticut, crossing the Line Brook. Now, I know all of you have seen this migration. Happens every year on Patriots Day in Massachusetts. The last year, I think it was over 30,000 people made the migration from Hopkinton. Hopkinton is celebrating the 300th anniversary. Hopkinton was named for Edward Hopkins, who was one of the founders of Hartford. Another long story there, but today, the marathon runs on a good portion of the Connecticut Bay paths that were followed by the pioneers. And just beyond is Whitehall Pond, which is a state preserve, which is recorded by tradition as a likely place that people at the party camped along the way. Now, all of us, you've probably been down Route 495 and the Mass Pike and saying, we want to get to Maine or wherever. And it's a crossroads. It actually was a crossroads 400 years or more ago of Indian Native trails. And there are commemorations of this within Westboro of the Connecticut Path crossing over Fay Mountain. And on Fay Mountain, there is the Jack Straw Monument. Jack Straw was an interpreter, a native who was an interpreter, fluent in English, who went with Wahinkinnicut to meet with Governor Winthrop. So he set up his home right on this crossroads, so he knew what he was doing. He was ready to provide services for all who came by. Beautiful sections start to really emerge of wild places, probably coming down from Fay Mountain with likely trail, roadways through Upton and down to Grafton, cut by the Mass Turnpike, and it's preserved. You could almost envision here a group coming down, and the roadway is so depressed that you could see that it was lots of feet traveling down through there to where that roadway went. Another Hassanamesset, otherwise known as Grafton, was a place of praying Indians that John Elliott established. And if you go there at the right time of year at the burial ground, the Prairie Indian burial ground, you'll see that it's still a place of importance to the Nipmucks. They bring offerings of corn to honor the people who were buried there, their ancestors. So now the paths break off here. There's a path going on to Springfield, the Bay Path, and our Connecticut Path breaks off. One of the places is Grafton. And leaving Grafton on the Common, and that sign, the Hooker sign, crossing the Quinsigamond and the Blackstone Rivers. And one of the things that's really, you think about the natives, they were really quite intelligent in doing this, is that they set out a trail that had very few big river crossings. They avoided big river crossings, and so this would be a fairly easy route, all the way from Dorchester to here, or from Cambridge to here. I'm going to show you, this one is one of the delights that you can find. You can go out the Waters Farm in West Sutton, which was the area, the site of the Manchog Praying Village. At Waters Farm and Manchog Pond, and it's now owned by the town of Sutton, Waters Pond Association. And if you, let's see, October 3rd and 4th, they're having their annual Waters Farm Days.
Go on the
3rd,
not the 4th. Come here on the 4th.
Okay, come on down on the 3rd, you know, that's all right. But go at any time because it's absolutely stunning. And it leads into a place that I didn't realize there were 3 miles of wilderness that formed part of the path. between Sutton and Webster. And you get a sense, you know, when you walk and your hair stands on the back of your neck, of a likely place. It gives you that sensation of what they may have experienced. So they came down to that place in Webster, which if you go up to the Memorial Beach in Webster, you can actually get a real good view of the lake. It's a beautiful lake, and it was another of the praying Indian villages that Chowbunagunkawag, and I'm not going to say this because we don't have time, could take longer, but it was one of the sites of the praying Indian villages. And you can see from Hasselmesset, Manchar, to Chowbunagunkawag, it forms a fairly direct route. And the wonder is that you have that great green space in between. The other wonder is, and it's something that this last year, we have a new national park, the Blackstone River Valley National Park, historic park, and we have a reauthorized historic corridor, the Last Green Valley Historic Corridor. And the Connecticut Path crosses those two historic areas. And as we call it into the Last Green Valley, it really is beautiful. And as a guide, Ellen Marnie, this is that treasure map of hers from 1874. You can go out and you can find places that you don't. Yes, this is it. Here is one of them. Quinnipiac River is a national scenic river. It's protected land by the West Thompson Dam, by the Army Corps of Engineers. They're celebrating their 50th anniversary. It's a beautiful piece of the path that you get down to the likely area of their crossing, and you can walk across here. The river's wide, the water is clear, gravel banks are easily crossed. And if you get there at the right time, as I had good luck to do, Osher Brook that drops right into the river there is a spectacular waterfall. It's 2 miles over through the wilderness. It's still a greenway. We arrive at the Wavequosset praying village that later became New Roxbury because it was settled by a bunch of folks who came from Roxbury and later renamed Woodstock. The path there is part of the National Register of Historic Places, the Old Connecticut Path, and that's the title of it. And I was fortunate a year ago to bring a group from the New England Historic Genealogical Society as part of their Come Home to New England. And we did a walk along the path there. So if you're looking for a nice, easy place to go, the Woodstock Historical Society does programs, walks, the interpretive programs, and it's a great place for driving country. We're really fortunate in Connecticut that you have about 11 miles of trail that we can access about 90% between four towns, across Woodstock, Eastford, Ashford, and Billington. There are the pieces. There are a couple of gaps, and hopefully with the work in the communities there, we can connect them so that there's a walking trail where you can either walk on or close to the route of path. And we've been doing some walks there also. Last fall, a year ago, we went out to Camp Nahaco, which was an old Boy Scout camp. Some of you in the crowd here may have gone there in your younger years. It's now a conservation land, and it's owned by the Woodstock and Town of Eastford jointly. We had about 75 people come out to walk the path. A stunning place. On October 4th, which is a big competition here, we're doing another walk into Yale Forest and Natchog Forest, walking about a mile into the woods. And it's a stunning wilderness. You can get about as close. I walked right up to the Beaver Dam and along the old road there and down to Bigelow Brook. And at Bigelow Brook, there's history that there were stepping stones there that were followed crossing the river. And there are times when this is very difficult to get across. There originally were a series going across, and Cavaliers walked across them. And then later after the hurricane in 1938, many of them were washed downstream, but there's one that remains. And I point this to you, and we're going to go walk down there. Remember when we talked about, they told you about crossing the Charles, that the natives had set stones so they could cross the river? This is on one of the Connecticut Path, and likely predates settlement there in the early 1700s. Now, up across Pine Hill in Ashford, Larned reported that this was a place of Thomas Hooker's encampment up on the hill. And the Connecticut Historic Commission took on the study of the Connecticut Path. And looking at maps and early surveys, they came up that this was the most likely candidate for the Connecticut Path. And if you go up there, it's on private land now. It's another one of those places you say, yes, right along the edge of it. And down along the Nipmuc Trail, Connecticut Forest and Parks has a segment that is actually right on the line of the old Connecticut Path. We took a group out there, another group of about 40 people, the trail steward actually put up a sign saying, this trail has been used for 400 years. If you just want to drive in the country up to Ashford, you can find the trail monument on Route 89, and it says John Oldham, 1634, Pastor John Wareham, 1635, and Thomas Hooker, 1636, right by the side of the road. Told you, just follow the signs. Now, one of the places that I want you to find out, explore, is up on the western part of Ashford into Billington. We have a 2-mile stretch that is already connected. And the marvelous thing is that there are 3 conservation areas along the way. So we've done some walks there on Connecticut Trails Day, and as part of Ashford's 300th anniversary, we went to Legal Farm, which is a Joshua's Trust Preserve, Langhammer Woods, and again, a group of about 35. It's a stunning place to walk. And to walk on a path, we had a great group walking the trail together and interpreting the trail, not just from the story of the path, but also having guides who were familiar with the plants that are there, the local history, to really make a connection on the environment. And another gem, 5 miles off of Route 84, on the path at the other end is Benton Ruby Park in Wilmington. It's a stunning place to walk, and you're right on the path. And we had 75 people show up to join us for a walk. So you see what I'm saying, when I started out by myself and all these people are starting to show up. Now you come out on a rainy night. So we have something that we have a 10-mile stretch, greater than 10 miles, and we have a 2-mile stretch that's already put together. Now the Connecticut Historical Commission really did an exhaustive study, and this is where you say, I have to admit my ignorance, that I did a lot of my field work and exploration before I read the study. And when I finally got to read it, I was there, God, what if they come up with something totally different? I actually came up very close to what I found. There were some differences, and here's one of them, because I'm in a territory where I'm going to hear from people who say I'm not doing it the way they said. They brought it out to Wilmington, as we agreed. And they said, Matthias Spies said it went through Bolton Notch. Okay, so we'll use that. And what they did was they said, well, we'll just connect what we found with what Matthias Spies said. In spite of the fact that we have no tradition, no recorded history, no physical evidence of roads, it's our weakest link, but you know, we'll go with it. A little bit of a difficulty there, but you know, we have Matthias Spies to thank for helping to find an alternative in letters that were found at the Connecticut Historical Society. He wrote to Harold Ayers and said, you know, Woodward and Safford came through and they went across from about the Willimantic River onto Windsor at the old ferry. And he said if they went, I know just how they would have done it. Because there was a trail that went like this. And it went across up above on Schnipsic Lake and on down to Windsor. And he said, you know, this other thing. He said, you know, there was this Nipmuc path that was on his map. And he said, you know, if they really did get to Tolland, they would have just followed the Nipmuc path on down to Hartford. So we get from Matthias Spies that he knew of the trail, and he knew that there was an alternative. And it really did work with what the Connecticut Historical Commission proposed up to Wilmington. And actually, in doing the field work in Tolland, there are physical evidence of the trail in the early roadway through Nyholman Park, or Nyholman State Forest. You can walk in the woods at Nyholman and you can find it. And there's survey data that verifies this, leading up to Tolland Green. And some absolutely brilliant work by Tim Gaudier over in Tolland, who compiled over 6,000 land records going back to the founding of the first settlement of the town. And he identified where the early trails were that came through from Western Tolland. There was the trail going, much as Spies had said, up around Schenipsit. There was what he identified as the Connecticut Path. It may have been a little bit later, but he identified it. And what was interesting, he said the deeds identified this thing called the Old Windsor Path, crossing over the hill from the common on down to Gagesburg.
But is he doing his work?
This goes back to the early 1700s.
Oh, okay.
So he was looking at the deeds going back to first settlement.
Oh, okay. Oh, but when was Timothy Gaudier doing that work?
Just recently.
Just recently, okay.
Yep. One of Tolland's historians it's an amazing amount of work to do that level of digging. So we have some verification from the land records of the path entering Vernon, where I'll be going in another week. And likely following approximately the course of the Tolland Turnpike on down the Tankerhusen Valley. And something that's come up in this process is that there's a place called Meeting House, where the first meeting house was set. It's a little south of the Tolland Turnpike. There's a marker up there now, and if you go up on the hill, you get a view right down the valley to Hartford. And one of the residents up there, Hans Weiss, lives on the hill and is an artist. And an artistic representation of, if you come across that hill, where there's an old roadway going up to the top, and there's the road, dating from the earliest settlement. It's likely, and we're still exploring this, it's likely the kinetic connection to what Tim Gaudier identified as the old path to Windsor. Another thing that we have going on once we get down the valley here is that it's very likely when you're driving 160 cows that you're thirsty. By the topography, you can head down the valley, and there's a wide open valley right in the area of Belding, wildlife management area, and follow down the valley. So it's likely there would be a branch down there in the valley. And one of my explorations there, the old burial ground, if you go and look at the names there, we have something else that happened in the settlements of these towns, is that you go and look at the first burial ground there, and you find the descendants of the founders of Windsor and Hartford. And among those was Moses Thrall, who's a descendant of William Thrall, who came with the congregation from Dorchester with John Merriam, was one of the original settlers of Windsor. So we're going to take a walk down there on September 26th. And try to connect. Belding is a wildlife management area, and it was a real beautiful area to get a sense of what the land was like back that time, now it's changed. And we also have it's adjacent to the old burial ground, so we're going to walk there. And leading us down from there, we come down the valley. And we're fortunate here in Connecticut, we have the Hockenham Greenway. So we have the tanker who's in Greenway and the Hockenham Greenway providing a connection right on down the valley of Hartford. So we get to Hartford and we get a sense of, you know, here they arrive and here's what it would be today about where they crossed. And again, thanks to Matthias Spies in one of his letters to Harold Ayers, he said, I know right where they would have crossed. Right about where the bridge was built, because there was a great sandbar there that they mined and excavated the gravel for much of the construction of the city. Okay, hey, great. Now it's changed. So if we take the old trails map that we overlay, what I think is the route, it really falls within the two trails that Spies identified and actually lines up with the Connecticut Historical Commission and Ellen Marney. So they've arrived, and you're here over in Windsor and saying, well, what about us? I think we're going about from the area of South Windsor, up along the line, Route 30, and out to the Connecticut River. We have our group arrive on the banks. And you can go down to the river. We went down to the river a couple weeks ago on Vibert Road. There's a South Windsor. There's a boat landing. You can get right to the river. And it would have been almost across from the Dutch or the fort and trading post. If they came across, you know, you have the wonderful Great Meadow, and you arrive here at the Palisade Green. So taking you on the journey, we hopefully found some of the places. But if I try to wrap this up, I'm going to do a couple of pieces that I had to put together in my own mind. That this had a shaping effect on our American story. And I do believe it. It's one of the things I didn't go into thinking that there was an American story. I'm not sure that there is one American story, but this may be a piece of it that there is. First, we have the folks who came down meeting in about the area of the old state house, in the old meeting house that was built there by the first congregation in America. And if we go into the meeting house and take a look around, on May 30th, 1638, the assembly met. And Thomas Hooker gave a sermon. And we thank Henry Walcott over here in Windsor for taking notes. And I found out that was actually a common practice, that you'd take notes in the sermons and then you'd study it. So here on the podium, Thomas Hooker came to his sermon and he took from Deuteronomy, taking wise men as your leaders. Set them above your tribes, and I'll make them rulers. Choosing wise leaders.
Where's Trump?
Yeah, where's Donald?
Oh, he's down there in the bottom row.
I don't know.
I've gone through this whole process thinking, what relevance would an old Puritan have to us today? Okay, time to move on. Well, what did Hooker say? Well, the choice of magistrates of your leaders is a gift. And it's not a gift that comes through the king or through someone else. It comes directly from God to the people. And because it's a gift from God, you really have a responsibility. It's like a religious responsibility to choose wise leaders. And the privilege is not one to be abused. You know, we talked about, according to their humors, today we call it political action committees, influence groups. But, you know, in those days you'd influence folks by, you know, maybe offering drinks at the tavern. But today we've got far greater means of influencing votes. But the franchise belongs to the individual, and it's not for his gain, but for the good of all. You think about the good of the community. And thirdly, that they who can appoint the officers can remove them if they don't do, meet their obligations. And, you know, that leaders have to serve for the good of the whole, for the congregation, as they would consider it. And if they fail in their duties, then they should be removed. And you have power to remove them. And if you think of, if Thomas Hooker did this sermon in England, he would be committing treason. So there was a reason they were hunting him down. He had to come to Connecticut to speak up. And Thomas Hooker joined with another strong leader, Roger Ludlow. He's one of the founders here in Newtown. And formulating the Fundamental Orders of Connecticut in January 14, 1639. That was my birthday. I was just 308 years too late. Something like that. By the freemen coming to vote from Windsor, Hartford, and Wethersfield. And some would say it was the first written constitution. And it really was a work of the communities, but unfortunately they had two strong leaders to help it and shape the contents. And I actually got to read the, I didn't set out this to read the Fundamental Orders, but I actually got to do it so I'd understand what happened. And the preamble reads much like the words of Thomas Hooker. A divine purpose, that there's a transfer of authority from God to the people, and it's a covenant. And Roger Ludlow had a profound effect on the orders themselves, which really established the rule of the people, established the beginnings of protection of individual rights and limits on government power, and it was ratified by the people. And I learned later that Roger Ludlow was held in such high esteem that around 1650, he was asked to codify the laws of Connecticut. So something good came through here. And this is the descendants of this, the children of the Fundamental Orders with the Declaration of Independence. As you read that, I am a U.S. Constitution that begins with the people. So the divine right of kings by these two individuals, by Thomas Hooker and Roger Ludlow, was overturned by the divine right of the people. And again, think of, they were doing this in England at that time, they would be committing treason. And the punishment for treason was rather gruesome. They hung you until you were almost dead. Then they chopped your body up before you died. And then they hung up all the pieces for others to see. So it was the most gruesome thing, punishment, and this was known. You have to come a long way to get away from that kind of power and authority. And the Puritans were a threat to the established order. So that's one piece. It did something that started in motion. And this is a piece of my own family history. And you'll find that I think in this room we're all probably cousins. I found that I have a lot of cousins. Abigail Ford was one, and her journey began in 1630 as a 10-year-old young girl with her family, Thomas Ford, that's her father. She was part of the crossing to Dorchester. She did not come with her parents in 1636 to Windsor. She started on another journey with her husband, John Strong. As of October 4th, we'll be having the Strong Howard House opening. It's of the same family. And they went from Dorchester to Hingham. Then they became founders of Taunton in 1638. Then they uprooted again to come to Windsor, where they became part of and leaders in the community here. And then in 1659, they headed on up. We're founders among many people in Northampton. Now think of this. You know, John Strong came and he had one son. His wife died during his journey. So Abigail, as a 16-year-old, became the mother of John's son. And along this journey, she had 16 children with John Strong. So if you wonder why there were a lot of strong houses up there, they had a lot of kids. So what's their legacy? Well, certainly there are those 17 children. And when John Strong died, he had 17 children, 144 grandchildren, 32 great-grandchildren. We have the Strong Howard House is one of the relics of the Howard Strong family. As I understand it, they also live just the other side of the Historical Society here. They have tannery in town. The Strong family continues to meet. Just last month in August, the Strong family reunion. They have people from all over the country come to the Strong family farm in Burnham. You remember that meeting house hill? That was owned by a descendant of John Strong, who drove his cows up the hill while using that old road, which might be the Connecticut Path. Now, why am I telling you this story about this, my family, and probably all yours? Because they were actually not much different than the hundreds, thousands of other families that came that had lots of children, uprooted repeatedly, and set out to find better opportunities moving on. And think of the difference that they made in their lifetime. They came from England, where most people were born in a village, and during their lifetime, they might move within 10 to 20 miles of where they were born. And here we have people who spent their families and the traditions where they spent hundreds, thousands of years of tradition living close to your village, and your hearth, and your kin, coming across the ocean, uprooting, and uprooting repeatedly at great hardship. And what would that impart to their children? Think of that message of you take a chance, an opportunity, you work hard, and you can make it. And the other transformation that happened, these folks came over from England, they were coming here to form a new England and reform and bring it back to England and show them how it's done. So England was still home. A generation or two later, America was home, but they were still loyal English. A generation or two later, a transformation occurred where they were a different people. They were Americans. And that was the year of bringing on the revolution. The third piece before I preach you some mercy and some transfer of pressure, the story of the path really is memorialized on the state capitol. It's part of Connecticut's DNA. Thomas Hooker's journey up there on the east face of the Capitol. Thomas Hooker himself is up there looking out over the city. And I really wanted to, I wished I could just talk to him. Well, just tell me, explain this to me, because there's still pieces that are missing. And he kind of pointed the way. When we look up, the answer was there. And the answer really was in three words, which my high school Latin is bad, so I actually had to look it up. And it translates roughly that he who transplanted sustains. And I found that this really connected with, this was adopted in 1640 by the folks who came to Connecticut, and still is here. So if you want to say, are there words that we could say represent something that they thought was important? And digging a little deeper in the story, it really tells the story, and it had a wonderful passage that really addresses all those fires where they were spending their nights talking with their large families about what shall we tell our children about what we've done. And you can see that they would likely draw on passages like this from Deuteronomy. What shall we tell our children? You tell them your God delivered you out of bondage and oppression, brought you to the promised land. And if you uphold his laws, and to your faith, and your God will sustain you in the promised land. Very powerful message that the Puritans actually identified with and seen themselves as, like the people who were brought out of bondage in Egypt to the promised land. If you think of the stories they'd have to tell and the sermons that they would hear while they were on board ship, while they were sitting in their tents on the shores in Dorchester, while they were walking through the wilderness, while they were uprooting and setting up new homes, that handing down this kind of strength in belief. I think as I work through this, that this ties together with what I see as an American story. And if we were able to say, what is an American story? Well, here's a strand of it. That you take the uprooting, the coming out of oppression, the finding opportunity, the willingness to take a chance, and living in a promised land. And I think of my other ancestors, my grandparents, David Ramsey, whose family came to build railroads, and my grandmother, Rose Parento, who came down from a farm in Quebec, Manchester, New Hampshire, and worked in the mills. That they must have heard this story or something like it of a land of promise, that there was something better life to be had. My wife, her Korean parents, all four came from Poland and through Ellis Island. And you think each of us has someone who came from another place. What was the story that they might have heard that caused them to desire to come here at great risk and odds? They prevailed and were sustained. And there were those who were brought here against their will. We listened to their songs, their spirituals, and it's a song, their songs of deliverance. And they were delivered 150 years ago at great cost. And the struggle went on for more than 150 years since then. But they were delivered and they had this faith in the story. So I really do believe, and it was something I didn't set out on this pilgrimage to find. I think it found me that there is, at least in my mind, an American story that we share. And the DNA of that story came from those folks who we list out here on time and on green, who came down the path and went west up to Agawam and Springfield, and who continued to go west all the way across the country. So we come back to the fire, and that's my story. We're living in an age of technology where it's very hard to get a group in front of a real fireplace. So we have a fireplace where we try to tell the story. And here I think is where it's important to recognize the place of telling the story to the next generation and passing it on. We have a story that we all share. I think it's a great story. That's how do we pass that story on? And that's a place where groups like yours here, the Windsor Historical Society, and the groups that I've met and worked with along the way, are so important in sharing the story and passing it on so that it's not lost. And that's our task. And I think going back to Thomas Hooker, that we need to take up the role as those wise leaders and pass this on so it will be preserved in a promised land. I thank you all. I'm going over my hour.
For more information, visit the Old Connecticut Path website. Follow the Old Connecticut Path on Facebook.